Laser review.
Hey guys, I got an argon iron laser on eBay for 30 bucks. It's missing a big cooler and a purpose, and it might be a while until I find both of those things. But I just figured out how to make it work, and that should be spectacular enough for a spot in this video. I only hope it leaves my wall intact. The power supply can put out a ridiculous 9 ampere at 150 volt, aka over a kilowatt. What is that supposed to be? That's actually the full output power of 40 milliwatt. Most of the remaining energy is turned into waste heat, which is why I'm turning it off right away. It was delivered with this nice adjustable fiber coupling and a little aluminium box. In there is an acousto-optic filter that lets you select the output wavelength. If I actually don't find a purpose for this thing, we'll totally take it apart and will be sorely disappointed. Because it's just a crystal with a piezo transducer. Let's have a quick, non-destructive look inside this one. Oh, hear that? Secure facilities. For good reason, it seems. I love warning labels, and this is a rare one. But as long as we don't smash the tube and inhale the dust, we are probably going to be fine. I'm trying to create some smoke to make the beam visible. Don't let it distract you from the cozy warm glowing of the tungsten filament. At some point, the controller automatically decides to ignite an arc. The light created by that gets bounced back and forth between two parallel mirrors, which amplifies it. But we can't really enjoy this before sorting out the cooling situation. If not water cooled, these guys need a huge airflow at least. That's why I've printed an adapter for an intimidatingly powerful ducted fan from Banggood. I think that'll do it. Now we can take our time and appreciate one of the best beam qualities in the game. And the clearly discrete spectrum that can be shown with a diffraction grating. But I'm still missing a purpose for this thing. In the meantime, next laser. The next exhibit is much smaller, but at least 10 times more powerful. It too is an eBay purchase that I made because of cheap and not because of need. This is an erbium-doped fiber amplifier. It actually amplifies optical signals seamlessly. When this is turned on and working, light is amplified while passing straight through. There is no slow conversion into an intermediate electronic step. That is what makes this technology incredibly fast. And this kind of device literally ubiquitous in modern telecommunications. It's based on a cheap 600 milliwatt laser diode. Its output is filtered by these strategically placed defects in the fiber. What remains is a super precise and stable laser light that has the perfect properties to excite the erbium impurities in the fiber. They are just waiting for an opportunity to lose some of that extra energy. And what better opportunity than to tag along an optical signal that comes through occasionally. In contrast to the fiber-coupled laser I've demonstrated before, all of these interactions happen within the fiber, which is very elegant. Some say the ultra-fast laser I've been fantasizing about in the SLA printer video could actually be accomplished by a mere mortal. For that endeavor, we are currently looking for a magnesium oxide-doped lithium niobate crystal. Or two.
Next.
For some reason, this Elex Maker Laser episode became my second most popular video of all time. A friendly neighborhood AliExpress shop thought they could do better than that, and I can't help but agree. They've sent a common CNC 3018 kit, and it's a toy, there is no doubt about it. But for a comparable price, it has a third axis, and it's a much more rigid construction than the Elex Maker laser. It could use a little bit of extra weight though. Then the weak DC motor can slowly work on soft materials, like wood, circuit boards, and vacuum cleaners if they are not careful. When going slowly enough, it can probably ablate soft metals too. But it's more like a grinding operation that'll destroy your tool in no time. And irreversibly embed it into the workpiece. You can choose various laser modules to go along with your kit. The 10 watt variant they've sent me is the highest power option. 4 times the power of what I had in the Elex Maker laser. At around 26 watt peak input, the claimed 10 laser watts are actually somewhat believable. Although I don't have an optical power meter yet to verify anything. So all I can say for sure is that it is plenty for the usual applications. It still can't vaporize copper, but solder mask for sure. You could etch serial numbers on circuit boards and anodized aluminium, of course. With a low price, it's a good machine for beginners, I think. I wish my first CNC experiments had been on such a high level. Hope you're not in a hurry, because I've got 2 more. I've talked about this O-Drive project before, briefly. It allows you to combine hobby BLDCs with encoders to turn them into real servo motors, which have a lot of advantages over the good old stepper. In many disciplines, it was the strongest candidate in my precision motion control comparison. I wasn't happy with the mounting options and the dirt resistance of hobby brushless motors though. So I got these in a standard NEMA enclosure on eBay. They even have a little compartment for their standard magnetic Hall effect sensors. Or possibly for something even better. With minor modifications, the awesome KUI incremental encoders fit in there perfectly. Resulting in a high-resolution, self-contained servo motor. These aren't exactly suitable for flood cooling in CNC machines, but as you might have guessed, we are building a laser machine. If you are in the market for a CO2 laser, I would strongly recommend not getting individual components, like this incredible tube and the high-voltage power supply. Instead, start with a $300 K40 machine to cover the basics and then modify it until it's good enough for your purposes. Because I started from scratch, I have to take care of water cooling, mirrors, lenses, holders, and I don't even get a pre-dented sheet metal enclosure. I wouldn't mind one of those, because in contrast to the Tesla coil, this power supply has plenty of power to maintain the high voltage, even if a careless human happens to touch it. It is even more dangerous than the invisible high power laser that'll effortlessly blind you with random reflections. What a marvelous combination. As a foundation for this machine, I've ordered a big CNC machined acrylic plate. It is the most expensive component in the machine, but not by far. It was surprisingly affordable for precisely machined 20mm material. And because all the holes for linear rails, motors, and the O-drive board are prepared, there is no way of screwing it up. Absolutely none. This is how I want to mount the components minus the ball screw on the X-axis. To get rid of that, there is a very clever two-dimensional belt drive technique. Corexy. Ever heard of that before? Me neither. But for a fast, light-duty machine like this, it has a ton of advantages. It doesn't twist the X-axis like a single-sided threaded rod would. And it needs an absolute minimum amount of hardware. I've purchased some better belts and pulleys over a month ago, but nothing has arrived yet. So this setup is more or less preliminary. But Core XY in general is a keeper, I love it. The last time I mentioned the O-Drive controller, I said something like, no holding talk. Given the internet's short attention span, it's no surprise that that stuck with people. Even though the next thing I said was,
I guess there'll be no noticeable difference once configured correctly.
Well, I can finally put that straight because I've taken some time to configure these extra correctly. They don't have holding torque, but they fight back as strongly as possible within their configured current limit. Listen to the load-dependent power supply fan. O-Drive has its own USB motion control API that allows you to configure trajectories, for example. Or you could turn off the motor and just record encoder data. Imagine a multi-axis robot arm that you can program by moving it manually. That's very powerful and only a fraction of what's possible with this thing. So USB control would be great and viable in almost all situations. But conceptually, it is not the perfect candidate. USB doesn't guarantee that a message gets passed through within a few milliseconds. Depending on what else the host computer has to do, there can be delays of up to 65 milliseconds. That's why CNC machines have to be controlled by real-time systems, like Linux CNC or an Arduino with a Gerbil firmware. I'm going to use the latter with the normal step direction interface and the core XY configuration flag. Also a little bit of a low-pass filter budge that is already implemented in newer hardware versions. The fine mirror adjustments are a bit tedious, but I guess it's better than mounting the fragile water-filled laser tube on the rapidly moving head directly. But ultimately a CO2 laser machine is cool. Unlike all diode lasers, it can cut clear acrylic because it has a 10 times higher wavelength. And as soon as I get inert gas air assist going, we can probably cut through wood as well, without setting it on fire. Last but not least, I went through a few revisions of my energy-efficient constant current laser driver, and I managed to fit it on a 50x50mm board in the end. The purpose is to supply power to a laser diode array. Only 1.8 volt, but at 40 to 50 ampere, without harmful ripples or transients. The input voltage can be 7 to 13 volt, and the laser current can be set with an analog control voltage or a PWM signal. It is ideally suited to drive this 30 watt fiber-coupled laser module. But the fiber bundle termination, or lack thereof, kind of kept me from doing more with it, like opening packages. While planning another lapping attempt, maybe with a proper lapping puck and diamond paste this time, I got an even bigger diode laser. Or two. These are 45 watt used Jenoptik modules. No severed fiber this time, but a neat and tidy SMA connector. Fiber pigtails for that can just be purchased online. And my constant current driver should be able to push these almost to their power limit. Now, two things are obvious. First, it's not a good idea to open these. A single dust particle on one of the optics can cause a cascading catastrophe. Second, I couldn't rest easy until I feast my eyes on the wonders that are hidden inside these blue beauties. I'm de-dusting one side of an acrylic sheet so that we can replace the cover immediately. Behold, a landscape of gold and copper. The golden waterfall are bonding wires for the laser diode bar. The slanted copper staircase turns the white beam into beamlets. Those are redirected by two prisms into a collimator made from cylindrical lenses to be coupled into an SMA terminated fiber. There is one optical power sensor in an LED package. And two temperature sensors underneath the diode bar. The sticker is probably a temperature high score list that allows the manufacturer to decline warranty repairs when someone hasn't been cooling enough. There's also a reverse polarity diode, maybe even a transient voltage suppressor. But if that thing gets blown up by the 50 ampere driver and it releases all of its magic smoke in there, the entire module can probably be thrown out anyway. So, I'd like to go one step further and operate the thing with the lid open. This is going to be leaky, so strap tight. Whoops. Well, that's one laser gone. Oh, never mind. The flashing is a specialty of my arbitrary waveform generator. Whenever I change the duty cycle setting, it briefly puts out 100%. But since my switching constant current source has a strict low-pass filter, it's no problem for testing. My camera has an infrared filter, so there's a lot more energy going to waste than we can see here. I'm a little surprised. Can't this be done more efficiently? But this was the final exhibit for today. You'll see it again as soon as I have a suitable fiber for it. And the O-Drive CO2 machine as well. Until then, thank you for watching and happy holidays.